What grace is mine?
Thank you, Patrick. That's the second song he's sung with the same tune, different words. He used that song before. He looked beyond my fault and saw my need with the same tune. Some of you would recognize that tune as, well, you think it's Danny Boy, but actually it's Londonderry Air. Thank you so much for that song. New one to me, the words at least. John chapter 11 this morning, John chapter 11 in your New Testaments. We're reading a lengthy portion of Scripture this morning for our text, John 11, beginning in the first verse as we look to the Word of God. Appreciate you being here in the service this morning, each of you. God always honors and blesses when we set aside time that's already His for His purpose, and we trust He'll manifest that truth to us once again this morning. We're in John's Gospel, chapter number 11. Beginning in the first of the chapter, verse number 1. Follow along your Bibles as we read John 11, 1. Now a certain man was sick, named Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. It was that Mary which anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore his sister sent unto him, saying, Lord, behold, he whom thou lovest is sick. When Jesus heard that, he said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. And when he had heard, therefore, that he was sick, he abode 2 days still in the same place that he was at, or where he was. Then after that saith he to his disciples, let us go into Judea again. His disciples said to him, Master, the Jews of late sought to stone thee, and goest thou thither again? Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours in the day? If any man walk in the day, he stumbleth not, because he seeth the light of this world. But if a man walk in the night, he stumbleth, because there is no light in him. These things saith he, after that he saith unto them, our friend Lazarus sleepeth, but I go, that I may awake him out of sleep. Then said his disciples, Lord, if he sleep, he shall do well. Howbeit Jesus spake of his death, but they thought that he had spoken of taking of rest and sleep. Then said Jesus unto them plainly, Lazarus is dead. And I am glad for your sakes that I was not there, to the intent you may believe. Nevertheless, let us go unto him. Then said Thomas, which is called Didymus, unto his fellow disciples, let us go, that we may die with him. Then when Jesus came, he found that he had lain in the grave 4 days already. Now Bethany was nigh unto Jerusalem, about 15 furlongs off. And many of the Jews came to Mary and to Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning their brother. Then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him, but Mary sat still in the house. Then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. But I know that even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give it thee. Jesus saith unto her, thy brother shall rise again. Martha saith unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus saith unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? She saith unto him, yea, Lord, I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which should come into the world. And when she had so said, she went her way and called Mary her sister secretly, saying, the Master is come and calleth for thee. As soon as she heard that, she arose quickly and came unto him. Now Jesus was not yet come into the town, but was in that place where Martha met him. The Jews, when they were with her in the house, then which were with her in the house and comforted her, when they saw that Mary, that she rose up hastily and went out, followed her, saying, she goeth unto the grave to weep there. Then when Mary was come where Jesus was and saw him, she fell down at his feet, saying unto him, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. When Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews also weeping, which came with her, he groaned in the spirit and was troubled, and said, where have ye laid him? They said unto him, Lord, come and see. Jesus wept. Then said the Jews, behold how he loved him. And some of them said, could not this man, which opened the eyes of the blind, have caused that even this man should not have died? Jesus therefore, again groaning in himself, cometh to a grave. It was a cave, and a stone lay upon it. Jesus said, take ye away the stone. Martha, the sister of him that was dead, saith unto him, Lord, by this time he stinketh, for he hath been dead 4 days. Jesus saith unto her, said I not unto thee that if thou wouldest believe, thou shouldest see the glory of God? Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead was laid. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me, and I knew that thou hearest me always, but because of the people which stand by, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me. And when he had thus spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. And he that was dead came forth, bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was bound about with a napkin. Jesus saith unto them, loose him and let him go. And let's pray. Father in heaven, would you loose the words of truth from your word to our hearts just now. Father, would you loose our hearts from the bondage that is there. They've been tied by wrong thinking. They've been tied by sin. They've been tied by things contrary to your word. Lord, I pray for deliverance and help right now to the needy hearts before me as we listen to the truth of God's word. Spirit of God, would you prevail mightily in our midst today, and would you do what no man could do? We wait on you to freely exercise your power among us. And Lord, would we cooperate with you both individually and collectively as a group. Lord, just make real and understandable the word of truth from your word this morning. We'll thank you for what you do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, this is late in the earthly ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ. Soon he would take his last trip into Jerusalem, where he would be both acclaimed and crucified, all in the same week. We're looking at a scene there in Bethany shortly before his last trip into Jerusalem, just days before that. And I would like for us to see three main things from this event. Many other things could be said, but I would like for us to see in the time that we have left this morning clearly the love of Jesus manifested in this account that we have of Jesus coming to the hometown, Bethany, of three of his beloved friends. We find a threefold reference in this passage to the fact that Jesus loved Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. Three times it is mentioned from the vantage point of different ones. First, we see that in verse number 3. We see these words in the third verse. Therefore his sister sent unto him, saying, Lord, behold, he whom thou lovest is sick. And that reminds us of the fact that Mary and Martha knew of the love of the Lord Jesus. I find it unique that in this passage in John, we find this multitude of references to the fact that people were aware that the Lord Jesus loved them. They were beloved of him, and they knew that. You know, our concept of God is wrong in many ways. It was just 1 year ago, exactly 1 year ago this week, I had made a recommendation to my brother for a particular book. I've made reference to that book, and some of you indeed have read that book. It was a very troubling book for me. The name of it is The Cure. It has a picture of a multicolored serpent, snake, on the front of it. And it was recommended to me by an evangelist friend. Quite honestly, I began reading the book two or three times and put it down. Said, I can't read this. I just can't get into it. I can't read it. And finally, at one point, it captivated my thinking, and then I couldn't put it down. I had to finish reading it. But there's a question that is asked on the cover of the book, and the question is this: what if God is not who you think he is, and neither are you? Now you say, well, from that description, it sounds like some sort of a weird book. Well, it's not weird, but our thinking is. And the question is raised, what if God is not who you think he is? And so the truth that we get from that, after I studied the book and the scripture that it was carrying, the scriptural truths, I found the sobering truth that we as human beings many times fashion our own God. You say, well, we're not idolaters. We don't make idols. We don't fashion gods. Oh, yes, we do, in our mind. You make God who you want him to be, and you perceive God the way that that you want to. There are many times that people perceive God as a severe, as a harsh, meanie Groucho up in the celestial area of space somewhere, who's just waiting for us to make a false move, and he's going to zap us with punishment. And that's not the picture that we see in God's word at all of God. We do know that God is holy and righteous and just, and he's full of justice, and he's judgmental of things that are against his nature. We know that, and we know that he will judge all sin and all wrong. We know there's a day of judgment coming. But the picture that some have in their mind is God is someone just to be in trepidation and fear constantly of. However, we see in other portions of Scripture the fact that God is love. Jesus said of himself that he was the way, the truth, and the life, and that he was love, and that God is love, the very essence of love. But we see that love manifest in this passage in John chapter 11. as Jesus extends openly, clearly, unmistakably his love for these three friends. I know that there is the general sense in which God loves everyone. Did you know God loves those that are against him, that hate him? He still loves them. Did you know that? Did you know that Jesus loved those that nailed him to the cross in a few days after this event? He loved them. He loved them. He made intercession for them. He pleaded for them. He asked, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. The scripture tells us that God so loved the world. That's everyone, all. Some have mistakenly tried to assume that God only loves a select few. It's not the way the Bible reads. God loves all. But in a special way, the love of Jesus was manifest in verse 3 to Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. They knew that. Verse number 5, look at this. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister Lazarus. And this is the observation of John, the author of the gospel. Did you know that there's a distinction that John had that was not shared by any other of the disciples in exactly this way, but Jesus, or that John was referred to as that disciple whom Jesus loved. He used that terminology to describe himself. John was acquainted with the love of the Lord Jesus Christ, and certainly we know that John observed that Jesus loved these. And then we see down in verse number 36, then said the Jews, behold how he loved him. Even the Jews, and we know that some of these were lost. They didn't know the Lord Jesus. They were in opposition to an unbelief in the Lord Jesus Christ. And even they could visibly see that Jesus loved Lazarus, that he loved these. So we see the love of Jesus manifest. Did you know that the love of Jesus is constantly being manifest among us? Now, some people get down on God, and they blame God, and they're judgmental against God, and they say, oh, God had no right to do that, and especially when things happen that are hard to understand. I recently heard within just the last few hours of a tragic happening in a branch of our family, and a part of my family, and some of you would know my brother-in-law, Walter Harrison, and he has a long history of tragedies in his family going clear back to his father, and they have a handful of instances right in his immediate family right there where loved ones have taken their own lives, and there's perhaps nothing in the world more difficult to deal with than that. And I must think when I hear about things like that, someone didn't know that Jesus loves them. And, you know, there's been discussions about people that take their own lives. There are some who have said that whenever someone takes their own life, they go straight to hell. Well, that's not necessarily true. Now, that's not necessarily true. There are believers who have done that. It's wrong. It's sinful. It's breaking the law of God. It's the most selfish, the most stupid act that could be done ever. And yet Jesus loves all of those. We see manifest constantly in a world that is needy to receive the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we see it clearly illustrated for us in John chapter 11, the love of Jesus as he approached Bethany at this time of need. Then secondly, we're thinking of the wrong thinking of the people that were weaving in and out of this narrative at the raising of Lazarus from the dead, the wrong thinking of people. And I know that you would find this perhaps not surprising, because there were people then that were thinking wrong about Jesus. There are people right now that are thinking, or people in this room thinking wrong about Jesus. There's always been wrong thinking. And how can we know that? Well, if your thinking doesn't line up with the truth revealed of God's Word, it's wrong thinking. It's wrong thinking. We adjust our thinking to bring it into alignment, to make it agree with God. In fact, that's the meaning of the word confess. If we confess, salvation is not possible without confession. And confession is to say the same thing about our sin that God does. That's to bring our thinking into alignment with what God has said about the wages of sin and the penalty for those wages, and that is death, eternal death, separation from God. Well, there was wrong thinking that could clearly be illustrated in John chapter 11. Look at the first instance that I've chosen to highlight in this. In the 16th verse, it came from Thomas. his surname Didymus, and sometimes we call Thomas what? What do we use for Thomas? We call him Doubting Thomas. There's a reason for that. But we see a statement that issued from Thomas which illustrates his wrong thinking. And he simply said this when Jesus lingering for those few days and said, let's go into Judea now. Let's go to Bethany. Let's go to that city that was just 2 miles or a bit less from Jerusalem. Let's go to the aid of our friends, Mary and Martha, because their brother Lazarus has died. And Thomas's response was simply this in the 16th verse. Well, we might as well all go and die with him. No, isn't that smart? Jesus said, let's go. And Thomas said, well, let's all go and die with him, because that's where we're headed. That is fatalism. That is fatalism. I know it's easy to suffer from fatalism in this horrible world. This is a horrible world that we live in. I know that, and you know that as well. I was recently doing some thinking about that. How many of you know what Murphy's Law is? Murphy's Law. All right, you know what Murphy's Law is. You know, we kind of smile and kid and joke about Murphy's Law, and we say if anything can go wrong at the worst possible moment, it will. You know, that's kind of Murphy's Law, isn't it? If anything can go wrong, it will. But did you know Murphy's Law is not godly? In fact, it's against the Word of God. I've had this discussion, this argument with others, and they said, well, preacher, I'm not fatalistic, I'm realistic. And that's godless too, because we are not bound by fatalism nor the cynical realism of the world that we experience and live in. However, Thomas was right there. He said, well, let's just go and die, all of us, because Jesus is gone. You know what happened last time we're there? They nearly got him dead, and they'll surely get all of us this time. Fatalism. That's thinking in terms of the devil's regime and of his power and of his system on earth. Now, I realize that some have said, and I even embraced this for a little while in younger years, and that is, well, I'm not fatalistic. I'm realistic. But sometimes there is just a fine line of separation between realism and pessimism. And that's pure homegrown pessimism in itself. We don't have to be pessimistic. We can be the most optimistic people in the world. Think of that, if you would. For the child of God, for the one who's been saved, washed in the blood of Jesus, forgiven eternally of our sins, ushered into the family of God, accepted in the Beloved, given all the rights and the privileges of the Lord Jesus. And by the way, Ephesians says that we've been seated and crowned with Him, and we have throne privileges along with Jesus Christ, so that every power, everything in this world has been put in subjection under Him and under us as we share those privileges with Him. How can you look at that as anything except victory? And think of this. What's the worst thing could happen? You know, people worried about current events and about money running out and about the stock market crashing. And in our prayer time this morning, we sort of reflected a little bit among the men that had been through the Depression and knew what was happening back then and all that. Some of you were born during the Depression. Some of you remember those days. And people worried about this and they worried about that and worried about not having food. What's the worst thing could happen to you? What's the absolute worst thing could happen to you? You don't have to answer out loud, but think of this. Suppose that you don't have any money, you don't have any place to live, that you starve to death. Well, that's not so bad, is it? For the child of God, that simply means eternity and the presence of God in heaven. I'm just like you. I'm sort of wimpy. I don't know how I'm going to die. If I die, I'm not sure that I'm going to die. I'm not making plans to die. Have no preparations for that. Have no burial place. No prior arrangements or anything. So I don't expect to use that. But if the time comes when I die and I'm translated into the presence of God eternally with a brand new body free from all this stuff, I just can't figure how that's a bad thing. Can you? And I'm like you. When it comes time to go, I hope it's fast. I hope it's fast. The worst thing that I could think of would be to have a lingering illness and to be a burden to people and have to look to someone to care for you and so forth, and some of you would share the same sentiment. I realize that, but let's just think about the wrong thinking of fatalism. Just get off that. Just leave it alone. Don't need to be fatalistic with God. You can think positively, victoriously. And Thomas was one who was thinking wrongly by expressing his fatalism. Secondly, in the 21st verse, we see some words. Martha said unto Jesus, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. And what I've titled that is simply Martha's agenda. Martha's agenda. Now, what was Martha actually doing in expressing that? She was really upbraiding the Lord, wasn't she? She's saying, Lord, if you'd come when I called for you, if you hadn't stayed 4 days, if you hadn't stuck around extra time, if you'd been here, my brother wouldn't have died. So do you realize what Martha's saying? She's saying, Lord, it wasn't right for you to linger. Lord, you should have been here. If you'd been here, he wouldn't have died. That's dangerous. That's dangerous. But you and I do the same thing. We do. We try to second guess God, and we try to take control, and we try to have our agenda. We think things need to go this way, and we try to dictate to God what he's trying to do rather than relaxing in the guidance and the care and in the sovereignty of a righteous and omniscient God. So there's that of Martha's agenda. And then we see in verse number 24 also, we're not beating up on Martha today. We got a Martha here, but we're not beating up on Martha necessarily today. Martha said unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection of the last day. Now think of this. Verse 24, Martha is echoing an Old Testament truth that was known by the saints of the Old Testament, that of a resurrection. The oldest recorded book in the scripture in the Old Testament, book of Job. And Job knew about the resurrection. He knew. He gave us a vivid reference to the time when he would stand again before his Redeemer. And Job knew that. The Old Testament saints knew about the resurrection. And so what's wrong with Martha's saying this in verse number 24? Lord, I know that he'll rise again at the resurrection day. Was there anything wrong? Was there anything untrue about that? No, there wasn't. It was absolute truth. That's true. And in fact, it yet awaits, because Lazarus will rise again and stand at the resurrection day. But see, Jesus was striving to get across to her. That is something that he would do unusually miraculous, not just according to some of the other miracles that Jesus had done, but he would then and there restore life to sleeping Lazarus. And so this would be Martha's possession of Bible knowledge, but her refusal of the proper application of that. And you say, well, that's confusing to me. Well, here it is. Let's just bring it down to 2014, could we? Did you know that you can know the Bible, you can know doctrine, you can know scripture, you can memorize it, you can have good knowledge of everything in the Word of God and miss out on the blessings of God? You can. You can be the doctrine detective of the church. You can correct the preacher on everything that he says, and you can still be dead as a doornail doctrinally. You can be in total denial and unbelief and failure to receive the truth of God's living word, as did Martha in this instance. So there's wrong thinking of people clearly seen in this passage. Still wrong thinking today, wrong thinking in this room this morning. There is constantly in our presence. And thirdly, we'll see the exhibition of God's power and glory. Verses 38 through the conclusion of our text, through the 44th verse where we read that. A mysterious verse nestled among this passage, and we find it in verse 35. It's the shortest verse in the English Bible, and it simply reads, Jesus wept. Now, I'm like you kids, like you teenagers. Whenever we had to memorize Bible verses when we were young, I always chose this one. I want to make sure that was in the list, because it's only two words. You can memorize it real quick and get credit for a verse. Could stand up and say a verse. I know we weren't always as reverent and sanctimonious about our motives for memorizing that, but nevertheless, it is the shortest verse in the English Bible. Jesus wept. Well, that's easily said, but not quite so easily explained. Did you ever stop and think about what motivated the weeping of the Lord Jesus on this occasion? Why did he weep? Did Jesus weep because he was sad because Lazarus was dead? No. No, he knew that in 5 minutes Lazarus would be alive again. That didn't cause his weeping. Did Jesus weep because of the people around him were sad and were sorrowing? Probably not. I think there's something that goes way beyond this. I think that Jesus realizes that in a few days, it didn't occur to him because being omniscient God, he knew it in advance from eternity past, but in days Jesus would be in the same spot. That Jesus would be in the same tomb. I think perhaps he's weeping at the unbelief of those that are surrounding him, understanding the passion of the hour that is approaching soon as he goes into Jerusalem and lays down his life freely, a sacrifice for all. Well, getting back to the exhibition of God's power and glory, we see some lessons from Lazarus raising, and I believe that it pictures the new birth, not resurrection. Lazarus was not resurrected, but he was raised from the dead. Now, there's a difference. There is only one who has been resurrected, and that's the Lord Jesus himself. The scripture describes his resurrection in this way. He is the first fruits of them that slept. The first fruits of them that slept. He's the first one in a very unique way that has risen from the dead and received a glorified body. So I want to remind you that when Lazarus came back from the grave, it was not a resurrection. He did not have a supernatural resurrected body as Jesus did in just a few short days after this. And so I believe this pictures the new birth. And we'll get to a couple of things that would illustrate that clearly, I think, rather than resurrection. First, we see the power of God. The power of God. When we think of raising someone from the dead, we think that there was an unmistakable statement of the death of Lazarus and the fact that he had been buried for 4 days. Now think about that if you could. There are a lot of critics of the Bible. They're unbelievers. They just simply don't believe God's word, and they come in various stripes and colors. Some critics of the Bible are like this. They say, well, I just don't believe that book. All right, then we know where they're coming from, don't we? Say, I just don't believe that. Others would say, well, there are portions that I believe and others that I don't, and so forth, and we know where they're coming from. They really don't believe it either. And then there would be those that would have to constantly be making up stories for how this might possibly have happened. For instance, like this. Well, perhaps Lazarus wasn't really dead. Maybe he was just gravely ill, and he went into a comatose state, and they placed him in the tomb, and when Jesus showed up, then he revived, he resuscitated, and he came forth. Well, I can see why some wrong-thinking person might assume that. If it weren't for the fact that Jesus plainly said, Lazarus is dead. And when Jesus said Lazarus was dead, he was dead, and that was it. So this was a raising from the dead. Only the power of God can accomplish that. And I'm thankful in ways for modern medicine and doctors, in ways I'm not. I think a good way to stay healthy is to stay away from doctors. You ever notice that? Just to stay away from them. I have some science behind that. It's more science than what some doctors practice. And my science is like this. Every time I go around a hospital or a doctor, there are sick people. Without fail. There are always sick people. Some are seriously sick. So I've made the scientific conclusion that the best way to keep from getting sick is to stay away from them. You say, now, preacher, you're being funny, right? Partly. Partly. Lazarus was dead. I'm thankful for the help that modern medicine and doctors can give us in ways. I also am not thankful for some of the things that they practice. By the way, you know why they call it practicing medicine, don't you? Sam does. Because they're practicing. They haven't found it out yet, but they're practicing. They're trying it out on you and on me. And I'm thankful for some that are able to implement some truths that they've learned. But anyway, the power of God is clearly seen because only God can do what Jesus did. Not only is there the power of God, but we see the faith response of man, the faith response of man. And here's why I say that this is a picture of the new birth, not of the resurrection. If it were the resurrection, Jesus could have simply stepped to the grave and said, Lazarus, come forth. He wouldn't have asked, would you take the stone away? He wouldn't have asked anything else. The last thing we'll see in just a moment. It is a picture of new birth in Christ, of new life in Christ. There's a faith response of man. Jesus said, take the stone away. They objected mildly. Jesus said, just take it away. Just remove the stone. And they did. And thirdly, we see new life in Christ. Jesus stepped forth and said, Lazarus, come forth. It has been said years ago by a preacher I remember as a young boy saying, if Jesus had not prefaced that statement with the calling of Lazarus' name, every grave would have opened and everyone would have come out. But he said, Lazarus, come forth. It was specific to Lazarus. It was indication of new life. Now, when Lazarus returned to the land of the living from the dead, we have recorded that he came forth bound hand and foot with grave clothes. Now we know it was the customary windings and wrappings and grave clothes that the Jews used for burial. It is exactly looking forward to the same wrappings that Jesus experienced days only in the future. And here's Lazarus hobbling forth from this tomb with his body wrapped and bound in the grave clothes. Now, what do you suppose the reaction of the people was when they saw Lazarus come forth like this? Well, I don't know what it was. It's not recorded. But I'm going to guess if it happened today, some of them took off and ran. They said, this is really spooky. I'm out of here. I'm gone. Others probably stood with their jaws dropped down a little bit. I can't believe what I'm seeing. Others perhaps in faith stepped forth to embrace the new life in Christ. And Jesus' response was simply this, loose him and let him go. Loose him and let him go. Now, who was it that undid the grave clothes, the wrappings from Lazarus? Perhaps his sisters, I don't know, someone in attendance there at the miracle. They loosed Jesus and let him go. One final application I would just like to submit to you about this. If indeed this is a picture of new life in Christ and the newness of life in the Lord Jesus Christ, the grave clothes might indeed be representative of our old sins of the flesh and our old trappings of the old nature of sin. And I would submit to you this morning that one reason that Christians are not more victorious because we're still wearing our grave clothes. Still wearing our grave clothing. We're still wrapped in the old trappings that bound us before conversion, before the new birth. And there is a way to let those fall off completely and be freed from those so that we can experience the freeness and the newness of life in Christ and the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I would plead with you, I would beg you this morning, if you're in Christ, if you're saved, if you know it, why don't you let your grave clothes drop off? That old stuff that has bound you and that has dragged you down for years and that has caused you to resist the great blessings of God, let them fall off. Cut them loose. Let them go. They're not worth it. They're serving you no purpose, no good whatsoever. Well, three great things that we've seen in this raising of Lazarus from the dead. Some have asked, well, a lot of things that I don't understand. There's the subject would come up of soul sleep. Soul sleep. Jesus said that he's sleeping. I go to awake him from his sleep. That terminology is used several times here. It's used in other passages of Scripture. There is no Bible doctrine of soul sleep. When someone dies, they do not go to sleep as far as a non-conscious existence somewhere. There is scriptural evidence that there is conscious existence immediately after death. Now, what happened with Lazarus? I don't know. I don't know, but Lazarus died and he came back, and I'm just trusting that God took care of all the details concerning that, because Lazarus was unlike us. It's a one-way ticket for us. The book of Hebrews says, and as is appointed unto men once to die, but after this, the judgment. If indeed Lazarus is a picture of new life in Christ, could we not learn some lessons concerning the power of the Lord Jesus Christ to fully grant to us the ability to live? I just am sure that Lazarus was the center of attraction for that whole part of the world in the coming days. In fact, if you read the next chapter in John, you'll understand that. And you'll understand why the hatred and the desire of the Pharisees to not only put Jesus to death, but to put Lazarus to death too, because he was a tremendous trophy of the grace of God. So that would bring to our thinking, it will alert us to the fact that if you're saved and if you're living new life in Christ, if you're letting your grave clothes drop away, you're going to be a nuisance to people around you. But let's be the salt and the light and the witness that God has ordained for us to be in this needy, needy world right now. This morning I've dealt with an unusual message in an unusual way. Never brought exactly this message before. But it's twofold application of this. If you're here without Christ, if you're dead in your sins, if you're wrapped in the grave and there's no life in you at all, would you receive the new life freely offered by the Lord Jesus Christ today? Christian, if you have been saved but you're still hobbling around in your grave clothes, would you change clothes today? By the grace and the power of God, you may freely do that. You can get out from under the wages, the effect of sin, in its practical sense right now in this life, and experience the fullness of mercy and grace and the fullness of victory and power in the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray together this morning. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for its truth. Lord, we need your help from your Spirit to take the word of God and burn it into our hearts. Lord, if there are those that ought to be making decisions in various different ways concerning the reaction to this truth, would you enable them to do that just now? And we thank you for your word and for the privilege and the freedoms that we enjoy just now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Rob's going to lead us in hymn number 335 in your Majesty Hymnals 335. Lord, I'm coming home. I'll be down front to receive you at the invitation time. If I could be of help to you, if you need to come to the altar for prayer, you feel free to do that as we stand together singing 335. Second.